Good morning. We're at 9:01, so we will get started this morning with our worship service. I want to welcome you all to Calvary, to our time together, and to our celebration today of Laity Sunday. So more than giving the pastor a week off, it more just gave the pastor a chance to concentrate on some other things that tend to get a little bit neglected during sermon preparation. So we will enjoy our time together as the lay members and friends of Calvary. Announcements today, I just wanted to thank everyone in Joel's stead for participating in the crop walk. I think we had 8 walkers last week that took the tour around Ada Hayden and raised money for the hungry. We had a really nice time. There was a good turnout, cookies, etc. from the mall donated refreshments for us after the walk. And we will get figures from that later on as to how much was raised as a group and how much will come back to our own Calvary food pantry. So we're thankful for that, and thank you for all of you who supported financially and also to those who took the walk with us. Also, I think Pat would like to remind everyone that she is collecting recipes for the November update. I don't know if it can be a fall recipe or just a family favorite of some kind, something that she can share. If you would submit that to her, I think she'd like those here pretty soon. So if you have something that's a fall favorite of yours that you would like to share, be it Thanksgiving related or just a favorite recipe, she thought that might be a fun way for us to connect together as a church family. So keep that in mind and get those to Pat if you would. And is there anything else that we need to bring up? All right. Don't see anything there, so we're going to do things a little bit the old-fashioned way this morning, at least for our opening hymn, and have a favorite hymn time. So we're going to get the hymnals out. Since I didn't know what you would suggest, I couldn't put them on the screen, but if you have something, we're going to share those. I had a couple given to me before the worship service started, so I don't think we'll sing every verse of every song in lieu of time, but we'll at least sing one or two verses of each one. So first of all, if you want to turn to number 707, and we will sing that. And if you have another one in mind, please shout it out. 707 is the hymn of promise. And let's do verses 1 and 3 today. Oh, look at there. Somebody's on it upstairs. Thank you, Ren. We'll do verses 1 and 3.
In the ball there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree, in cocoons a hidden promise, butterfly.
The next one that was lifted up to me before the worship service today is number 504, The Old Rugged Cross. And let's do verses 1 and 4 on that one too. We'll open it up and then we'll wrap it up with verse 4. Number 504, or on the screen. Thank you, Ren. He's flying solo up there, so juggling 2 PowerPoint shows and getting the words in there for us. So hats off to Ren.
Thank you. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners.
Another 377. It is well with my soul. You might have beaten Pastor Steve to that one. That ranks on his list of favorites as well. How about if we do verses 1 and 3 of this hymn? Number 1 and 3, 377. It is well with my soul. That hymn, I love the verse, it is well with my soul, because our sin is nailed to the cross and we bear it no more. And we'll see that in our scripture passage today. So it was a very fitting hymn. Thank you. Maybe we have time for one more. Or one verse of one more at least?
593.
Here I am, Lord. This is also very fitting with Laity Sunday. So the Lord directs us in thematic ways. So let's do just verse one. Is that okay? Verse one, here I am, Lord, number 593. This leans very well into the next part of our worship service, and we're going to swap around this ministry moment with the scripture lesson so that the scripture can tie in more directly with the message. But we want to acknowledge someone amongst our, or a group amongst our lady who has come together to really live out this message, whom shall I send? Someone who listened to the call of God and answered it faithfully. And so I would like to invite Marilyn Stenberg to come up and share kind of a ministry moment about their work through Alice's Place. And that is something that the entire church has rallied around. And so as we celebrate Laity Sunday, I know there are many, many others who have answered the call in so many different ways. But this is a special one that I thought we could highlight today. Marilyn was willing, and so she's just going to share with you a little bit about how Alice's Place came in to be and what is happening there now. So Marilyn, thank you so much.
Good morning. Thank you for this opportunity. Many of you have heard the story about Alice's Place, so this will be an update. And for you who have not heard about it, this will be new for you. On Main Street in Radcliffe, also called Isabella Street, is a brick building that was the old telephone office. Back in the day, we were not supposed to make telephone calls after 10 o'clock unless it was an emergency. Alice Stenberg, who was Red's mother, was the night operator, and she would have to get up and answer those late calls. Alice and her two children, Karen and Ronnie, she called him Ronnie, moved into the building in about 1952 when Red was 11 or 12 years old. They had been living in a very small house with their Grandma Fickner, Red's, Alice's mother, and Red slept on a rollaway bed that they pulled out every night into the living room, and then they opened it up and he slept on it, and then the next day they folded it up again and put it away. It was a tiny house. Red and Karen were very excited to move into a home that had running water, a bathtub, an air conditioner, and lots more space. Red remembers the first night they stayed there. He and Karen each ran the bathtub full of water and took a bath. Before making the telephone office their home, they had to take baths in a round metal tub filled with water, carried from across the street at a neighbor's house, and heated on the stove. Karen always got to be first and Red second, which he became tired of over time. He told his mom, "I want to be first." She said, "You're second." The building, now well over 100 years old, was gutted several years ago. And as you can see by the pictures, that picture there is the first time Red saw it. We went up on a Sunday after church, and so it was in bad shape. Red had teasingly told the boys some time ago that he would like to see the building fixed up to look better. Our four sons felt that their dad, who worked hard all his life, needed a good project in retirement. Most of you probably know he had done concrete work as his occupation, and that is very hard work. Radcliffe has an event called Radcliffe Days in July of every year. Well, in 2019, during Radcliffe Days, Red paid a visit to Dick Drake, the owner of the building, and asked Dick what he planned to do with it. "Why don't you sell it to me?" Red inquired. Dick asked him what he would do with it. Red said, "Well, it would not be a tavern or a restaurant, maybe an apartment." Mr. Drake passed away shortly after that conversation. On November 22, 2020, Tim, our second-born son, called from Sioux Falls, South Dakota on Red's 80th birthday with a very special birthday surprise. We could not celebrate Red's birthday that year because he had COVID. Tim had purchased the building from the Drakes sight unseen, and he had a project in mind for his dad. The goal of the project was to renovate the building into a three-bedroom apartment, then establish a nonprofit that would provide a home for a single parent who could use some help getting back on his or her feet. The building would be renamed Alice's Place in honor of Red's mother, who was a single parent. Now Red had a project, a very big project, as you can see. I mean, it was really a mess. The windows were all boarded up and the building was not attractive at all. The floor on the south half of the building was non-existent, and the floor on the north half was extremely weak, just kind of soft to stand on. I was standing on it, and you could just feel it kind of move, and it was really scary. I wanted to get out of there. But the building was 24 feet wide by 48 feet long. So when I talk about the south half, I'm talking about the south be 12 feet by 48 feet. The building was in desperate need of a new roof. We could see the sky from inside. We had to borrow the money to get it done, but it was completed in late 2021. An engineer friend told Red we should reinforce the ceiling trusses before a new roof so it would be safe for the roofers to be up there. Then a new cellar door was installed. Then Red started framing the walls inside. He began those renovations in 2021, working alone most of the time, so it really was a slow process. Later on, members of the family pitched in to help. New doors and windows have all been put in place by a carpenter. Professionals were also hired for the tuck pointing, outdoor painting, drywall work, carpet installation, electrical, plumbing, and mechanical work. And also a carpenter put in the kitchen cupboards. A new concrete floor in the basement and a new sidewalk along the north side of the building was poured by our oldest son, David, and his crew. But Red put in new laminate floors, framed the walls, and other interior work. A fun part was looking for furnishings. We had very little money and received some furnishings as a donation. We did a lot of shopping at Habitat for Humanity. The dining room set, which you can see in the over there by that window, we got that for $150. I thought that was a good buy because it's really nice. The kitchen light was brand new and we got that for $25. Things like that really helped. It is not a Better Homes and Gardens decorated house, but it is comfortable and very livable. Alice's Place became a corporation with me, the daughter-in-law to Alice, as president, Denise, her oldest granddaughter, vice president, and Hattie, my granddaughter, and Alice's great-granddaughter as secretary. Mark, our third son, and Alice's grandson is serving as treasurer. We also have a member of the Radcliffe Town Council on the board. We applied for the nonprofit status in October of 2021 and received a letter granting the status in early 2022. This made it possible for people to receive a tax deduction for their donation. The project has been a labor of love for the entire Stenberg family. Each of our sons has had a hand in the renovation on some level. Thomas, our youngest son, has been a great help working alongside his dad all last winter. Our grandson Elijah also worked hard alongside his grandpa. A couple of our nephew-in-laws have also helped out. Red said he could not have accomplished all this without their help. Now the project is completed and the dream has come true. I am happy to report that God answered our prayers in finding a single parent to move in. We now have a single mom and her little girl living there rent-free. She just has to pay for the utilities. We are very thankful to everyone who has helped us in making this project a reality, whether with financial donations or in-kind gifts. Now for the rest of the story, as Paul Harvey would say. There was a very ugly blue building beside the telephone office. You see it, the picture? Red offered the owner to paint it for free, and he said no. He did not want it to change. Well, he died a few months ago, and his spouse needed money and was willing to sell. So we bought it for $4,000, which we thought was pretty good. We knew it would make Main Street look so much better, but we did not take into consideration the removal of any asbestos that might be in it. Well, there was asbestos. It cost us about $5,000 more to get rid of that, and then we had to pay to have the building taken down and it taken to the landfill. But as you can see from the pictures, it looks much better. I think he's got a picture of it, yeah. But we have very money left in the bank. But we got good news just a couple days ago. Someone who had contributed early on with her IRA money, you know how you have to take it after you get a certain age, she told us that she's going to give us part of her IRA money for this next time that she takes it out. So that is going to be exceptionally helpful. So thank you. If you have any questions, you can ask me after church.
Thank you so much, Marilyn. And how fitting just to fit in that from the last hymn we sang, Here I Am. They heard a call, they had a dream, they prayed. I know we prayed in Sunday school over and over. I know that they prayed hard that God would just meet their needs to see this come true. So this is indeed not just a charitable project, but a labor of Christian love. And we pray for the tenant and her little girl that the light that can be shown for Jesus will overflow to them because of the love that was poured into that house. So thank you so much. Thanks for sharing, Marilyn. That's just one of the things that the lay people of Calvary can celebrate together. So I'd like to turn to our scripture lesson, which, Ren, I forgot my phone, and I usually read it from there. So if we can jump in, this is Hebrews chapter 10, verses 19 through 25, and I'm reading from the New American Standard Version today. Therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he inaugurated for us through the veil that is his flesh. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds, not forsaking our own assembling together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Okay, so why celebrate Laity Sunday? That's not something we have been in a traditional habit of doing since Steve and I have been here. But in the short version, since coming together with Cambridge, they have a tradition of celebrating Laity Sunday. And so as Steve preaches through a pretty complex book in the book of Romans, for him to stagger and preach 1 week here and then preach the same sermon there while preaching a new sermon here back and forth, we thought, well, maybe we should just talk about and have a little bit of a Laity Sunday here. Cambridge has a certified lay speaker, so they have someone to jump into the pulpit. And I apologize that you just get a former certified lay speaker this morning. I have not kept up with my certification since life got busy at our house. But I want us to take a little break from the book of Romans and consider what God calls us to do as the congregation of the body called Calvary. So in the longer version, we'll look at a peek at the history of Laity Sunday. What is actually the difference between lay and clergy, and why do we have that difference? And then our importance of being together in fellowship. So in the history of the American Methodist movement, the lady served a very big role. There were circuit riding preachers that would share a large circuit of area while the country was being settled, and they would maybe preach at one place every couple of months or so. And so it was really the laity, the people of the church, that had to serve the functions of the church to keep it going between those visits. And today, it's still the lady that plays the major role in the life and ministries of the church. The first official recognition of Layman's Day, sorry ladies, that was back in the day when it was men only, but in the official recognition of Layman's Day in the Methodist Church was in 1929, and the aim was, to quote them, to emphasize the place that lay members have in the total life and work of the church. And the United Methodist Church continues to take one Sunday each year to continue that emphasis. That is typically the third Sunday of October. So while we take the time to celebrate the ministry of the laity, specifically once a year, it is a good thing, but we can subtly perpetuate this thinking that laity is less important than the clergy. They get 52, 53 Sundays a year, and we get one. So we often get that backwards, though. Many denominations have allowed a hierarchy that allows places clergy into roles for which they were never biblically intended. We call them reverend, we call them father, pastor. We can tend to set clergy on a pedestal. We expect that our hired clergy will do the majority of the work in the church, and we can get the mentality that we come to church on Sundays, but let the hired man take care of the rest. I don't believe this elevation of the clergy was ever the intention of the Lord. In Acts chapter 6, we can begin to see where there is a slight division in the roles of people within the church, what we might term lay and clergy nowadays. But there was really nothing other than a division of duties, not so much a division of importance or level of vitality. The church at the beginning was growing at an amazing rate, and the apostles were accused of neglecting the widows of a particular sect. The work was overwhelming, and the apostles just could not do it all. So there was a consensus arrived that the apostles would delegate certain duties to capable and spirit-filled, that's important, men, to oversee some of the work of the day-to-day ministries of the church. We can tend to think, well, they elevated themselves to only preach and teach, and everyone else had to feed the people, clean the toilets, etc. But this really was not the case. It was very much dedicated that they were to be men filled with the Spirit who took these duties. And as an example of that, Stephen, the first martyr, was one of those men. We don't ever see him as being unimportant. So we don't want to ever think that the roles make someone more important or more vital to the life of the church. So the apostles then stated that they would devote themselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word, and they left the rest of the activities of the church to the lay people. Everyone was better served when each understood and fulfilled their own roles. This concept is the basis of a group that Steve has been in for many years called the 6-4 Fellowship, taken from Acts chapter 6, verse 4. And it's a network of pastors who group together to encourage one another as they dedicate themselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word. It has been said that there should be an hour of prayer and study for every minute of a sermon preached. So you can see in a brief 20-minute sermon that can take 20 hours of prayer and study to develop that. That's half of a typical 40-hour work week. And add to this the actual writing of the sermon, the administrative duties that are required at the local, district, and conference levels, meetings, visitation, pastoral care. It's no wonder that pastors are overwhelmed. Hence the vital importance of the ministry of the laity that we emphasize today. So we need to begin by clearly understanding these roles and not redefining them in our own way. It is not the pastor and then everyone else. We need to guard ourselves that as churches, we do not become clergy dependent. Not surprisingly, pastors are not equipped with all of the spiritual gifts listed in the Bible. One person or even a team of pastors cannot carry out every function within a local body. Serving in the district office for a while opened my eyes to this reality when I was the one fielding the complaints about pastors that would come in routinely from local churches. The complaints varied in scope between things about theology or style or lack of visitation, poor administration, just a variety of things, which all would be maybe listed in that list of spiritual gifts, but one person cannot do it all. So biblically speaking, the role of the clergy from Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, is to equip the saints, which is you, for the work of service. The role of the laity is to carry out those works of service in the life of the church. Pastors come and go, but those of you in the church family are the living stones with which the church is built. The pastor's most important role is to give you the tools you need to build yourself up in the Lord. And the most vital of those tools is to increase your knowledge of God's word. I can tell you for sure that your pastor takes this task very seriously. And there are important ministries here at Calvary that show that many of you take this seriously as well, your own roles in the life of the church. Your generous giving of your time and your resources maintain our food pantry. We partner with the Bridge Home and Friendship Arc, lead children's ministry, adult Christian education, and music ministry. You have sent people into full-time ministry and out onto the mission field. You maintain your building and your grounds beautifully. You remember shut-ins, raise funds for special projects while enhancing fellowship with garage sales, dinners, etc. You bless our community with the live nativity and Holy Week offerings. Your love and support has played a part in the dedication of Alice's place. The building was full when we had a dedication ceremony there last spring, and there were almost everybody sitting in the pews here was there. So we're all together in these things as a church. And most recently, you may not see it this way, but you actually commissioned and gifted Joel to go out on his own and share Christ in his new environment with new housemates and new staff. And when he left, he said, God is calling me, and I want to show my staff and my housemates what it means to follow Jesus. And the discipleship opportunities and encouragement that you offered him, offering him participation in the life of the church, regardless of his disability, has blessed our family so much and equipped him for this role. So as we turn now, after talking about little history, what the roles are, we turn to our scripture passage. And so touching briefly on the role of the pastor to bring the word of God, the Bible, to you each week. And the written word from Genesis to Revelation points us to the living word, which is our Lord Jesus Christ. From the types, shadows, and prophecies of the Old Testament to the glorious fulfillment of all things in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, we have the foundation for the place our scripture passage begins. Because Jesus inaugurated a new and living way for us through the perfect sacrifice of his own blood, we can now enter into God's presence with confidence. We do not need to shrink in shame over our sin. If you have surrendered control of your life to Jesus, your heart has been sprinkled clean from an evil conscience. And I've walked with the Lord for 40 years, and I still cannot wrap my mind around that truth. My conscience yells at me every day, and I see the evidence of my sin everywhere I turn. But God's word reminds me that I have been cleansed within, even as I continue to strive for holiness in my life. So in the light of what Jesus did for us, Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. The Greek word translated this way is used only here in the New Testament and is based on the idea of an upright object not inclining at all from a true perpendicular. If I stand my pencil up, you can see I'm shaking because I'm nervous. It's wavering from true perpendicular, and it's hard to imagine anything not shaking just a little bit with its foundations, but that is what we have been given. On our own, it's impossible. We have all encountered seasons of struggle and doubt and nervousness where we waver, but we cling to the second half of this verse, for he who promised is faithful. So I notice here that we are not only called to hold fast to our hope in Christ, but we are also to hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, to the sharing and proclaiming of it. We can stand with strength and confidence because he who promised to fulfill his work in us is faithful. Not only does the writer of Hebrews give us this reminder, Paul does as well. When he is expressing his gratitude for the Philippian believers in chapter 1, verse 6, he states this: I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect and complete it until the day of Christ Jesus. So it is not only this confession of our hope that enables us to fulfill our mission as the church. Verses 24 and 25 give us the rest of the picture. And let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds, not forsaking our own assembling together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Some versions will translate the word stimulate as to spur on or stir up. So whatever the translation, the word is strong, and it means incitement. Typically, we think about that as being inciting a riot, inciting something big and massive and powerful. So that is what we are commanded to do one another. We to incite one another, to spur one another on. I don't imagine when a horse gets a spur in the side, it feels very good at the time, but it does plunge him forward in his work. Commentator Leon Morris states that the one another part of that, stimulate one another here, is a mutual activity, one in which believers encourage one another, not one where leaders direct the rest as to what they are to do. A congregation surely needs a good pastor who will faithfully teach the scriptures, but equally important is our consistent and loving encouragement of one another and the incitement of one another to love and good works. And the love here is not brotherly love or familial love, wonderful as those are, and we feel that in a very strong way here at Calvary. But the love that we are to be stirred up for is God's agape love, the supernatural, non-natural, self-sacrificial love of God. One of the study tools I use is Kenneth Wiest's expanded translation of the New Testament, and I want to read to you his translation from the Greek of verse 24. And let us constantly be giving careful attention to one another for the purpose of stimulating one another to divine and self-sacrificial love and good works. We need each other to keep the ministry of the church alive, active, and vital. I know I need your careful attention in my own life to stay encouraged in the work of ministry. Verse 25 continues on in the same sentence as verses 23 and 24, so let's read it again as a whole thought, this time from the English Standard Version. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful, and let us consider how to stir one another up to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. So I believe verse 25 gives us one of the most important tools we have in our ministry as the laity, not forsaking or neglecting our meeting together as believers. There are many things that can distract us in these times from attending worship and from being involved in each other's lives, but I believe that each are vital, corporate worship and friendships outside the church walls. We are very busy, we're distracted, and we're isolated. Social media and streaming platforms have made it very easy to just stay home. COVID certainly brought upheaval to the church, and I am so thankful that during that time we had Zoom and streaming. They were wonderful tools to sustain us during those lonely days of COVID. but they cannot replace face-to-face worship. So as we've continued to come together, to gather around the tables downstairs, to gather around and study at Sunday school, to enjoy our fellowship time, TNT, I talked to Steve the other day and it sounded like rousing conversations were happening there on Wednesday mornings. So those things are very important, that face-to-face contact. I think we're so happy to be back in touch with one another. I know I tend to be an introvert and a homebody, and I had a job that really didn't change very much in the face of COVID. I went to work the same days, I did the same things, I just did it with a mask on. So I was not one of those that was supremely isolated during that time. But even then, you just realize when you came here to record in an empty church, it was just a very weird feeling. It would be us and Ginger and Joel and maybe one who would sneak in up the back balcony now and then to help us out and give us an audience. But being together is just so much better, and it's so important that we don't neglect that. So I know that I need you to keep my hope alive, to remind me of the promises of God as we meet together. But I am thankful that those of you who watch on streaming and attend Sunday school via Zoom, I am thankful that we have those platforms. I'm not trying to deny the importance of those as well. But I'm so thankful for my friendships in the church and for the faithful teaching of God's word in worship, in Sunday school, in Bible studies. The passage closes with an even deeper exhortation. Our assembling together, formally and informally, is to be habitual, as opposed to the reverse of the comment, as is the habit of some, to neglect meeting together. We are to encourage one another with the thought of that being a rallying of one another as soldiers for battle. And we are to do it all the more as we see the day of Christ's return drawing near. Now, I came to Christ in the mid-1970s, kind of at the mid to tail end of the Jesus movement of those days. So seeing some of that rekindle nowadays is just so exciting and encouraging to me. But at that time, there was a big emphasis on the return of Christ being imminent. I remember hearing Billy Graham speak that he expected to see the return of Jesus in his lifetime. And that was in the middle 1970s. We all know that Billy Graham died in his 90s before actually seeing that day come. So I know that there have been people my entire life that have said Jesus' return was just around the corner. And there have been signs in almost every generation that led Christians to believe that they were the end time generation. The conquest of Rome against the Jews in AD 70, World Wars I and II, the rebirth of Israel in 1948, current violence in the Middle East, today's societal evils, and the advent of true, instantaneous global connection via the internet. But no matter what the timeline, we are assuredly 50 years closer than we were when I first met Jesus, and my own demise and meeting him might be tomorrow. I believe each generation is called to live as if Christ's return is just beyond the horizon as an end time generation. So in light of all that, I believe the Lord is calling us in these days to conversations deeper than how the cyclones played, or what the weather will be tomorrow, or what the grandkids are up to, what happened at work. I believe we are to be sharing with one another what we are learning from God's word, how he has used us, how we are gaining victory over sin and doubt. Don't get me wrong, I listen to the Cyclones and the Hawkeyes on the radio. I'm excited to see Brock Purdy's success. That has been a joy to follow, along with his faith in the Lord. Steve and I have season tickets to the wrestling meets. We go to the basketball games. We keep up with the grandkids, or try. We talk about work, what's for supper, our schedules, and the like. And those things are all very important. But as we read the headlines and see the day of the Lord drawing nearer and nearer, we need to go deeper as well. We are in deep spiritual battles in our society today, and not one of us can stand alone. We need to be real and honest and accountable with each other in our Christian growth so that we may indeed hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, and that we may, as it says in Jude verse 3, contend earnestly for the faith once for all handed down to us as the saints. So as the laity of Calvary United Methodist Church, let us all remember the vows we took at our confirmation, baptism, or profession of faith, to uphold the ministries of the church with our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, to the end that the name of Jesus Christ is glorified in our community, and that all we serve in that name will come to know his love and grace. May we absolutely spur one another on to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. Let us pray. Father, we know that you don't need us for anything. You can accomplish your will with a word, as you did when you spoke creation into existence. But you also had a plan from the foundation of the world that the Lamb of God would be slain for our sins, that he would be dead, buried, resurrected, and ascended to heaven to sit at your right hand, to intercede for us, and to direct us as we minister in his name. Lord, we know that even those we give a cup of cold water to in the name of Jesus, we have done it to him. And we are so thankful, Lord, that you stoop down to include us in your work, that we can have that glorious satisfaction of seeing that we are an important part of what you do. Not that you need us, but that you have chosen us to be a people that proclaim your name and that we confess our hope in you without wavering. So I pray, Lord, that you will give us the strength to do that without wavering, that you will keep us strong and tall and perpendicular, aligned with you straight up, but also aligned with one another side to side, hand in hand, face to face, and help us, Lord, to go deeper, to encourage one another, to build each other up so that we might be a light on this corner in our community. We pray this in Jesus' holy name, and we pray the prayer model that he taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you for allowing me to share with you today, and we will now join in our final hymn. This is going to be to the tune of "Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing," which is one that is very familiar for us, but the words will be to number 566. So for those of you who read the music, I apologize that it will not match with the words, but it is something a little more familiar to us. So I invite you to stand and sing, "Blessed Be the Dear Uniting Love." This is a good Wesleyan hymn about the importance of community. And as a benediction, we continue in the book of Hebrews from chapter 13. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.